You're listening to an archived Cabral Concept podcast. After listening to this show, check out the most up-to-date podcasts available at stephencabral.com/podcasts or search directly on iTunes. And now, welcome to the Cabral Concept, where board-certified naturopath and integrative health practitioner Dr. Stephen Cabral shares how he was diagnosed at the age of 17 with a life-altering illness and given no hope for recovery. It was only after studying and traveling all over the world did he discover how to combine ancient Ayurvedic healing practices with state-of-the-art naturopathic and functional medicine to fully rebalance the body and re-energize it with life. It's time to discover how to get well, lose weight, and finally feel alive again. And now, here's your host, Dr. Stephen Cabral.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to the Cabral Concept. I'm Stephen Cabral, and today I want to talk to you about Weight Loss Wednesday. Our topic right now for today is, can food sensitivities increase weight gain or not really allow you to lose weight properly? So that's my big takeaway from today is, if you can think about this, that when you put certain foods in your body, they're either going to react positively or they're going to react negatively. Very few foods are neutral. So the important thing to look at is this. We know a lot of processed foods, like let's just say chips and just processed breads and things like that, they're obviously not what we consider health foods. But there's a lot of foods that can be actually healthy for you or considered health foods that your body would actually react negatively to. So that means you could be eating eggs, and eggs are obviously a very healthy food for a lot of people, but not for everyone. So there is no one food for every single person that could be considered healthy. So the reason why I pulled out eggs here today is because when I do food sensitivity testing, a lot of people are actually sensitive to egg whites. So, and the white for a lot of people who are trying to lose weight is what they center on and not even the yolk. And because they think that the yolk is bad, it's been demonized, all of these things. Now, for a certain subsegment of the population, they should maybe not eat egg yolks, but for the majority of the people, it can be perfectly acceptable. Let's step back for 1 second. So when you eat foods that are healthy in general, that you think are healthy, and your body actually has a sensitivity to that, that means when you put them into your body has an immune-based reaction. So it can be many different types of immune-based reactions. There's short-term quick immune reactions, like let's just say you ate shellfish and you started to get hives, or you got a little bit of a rash or a headache or upset stomach, whatever it might be. That's a short-term kind of IgE-based immune reaction. That means you're having a fast reaction to that food. But a lot of time, you can be having a longer-term reaction. It could be 24, 48, or even 72 hours later. And those are latent-based reactions. That means today's a Wednesday. You could be looking at foods you ate on a Sunday or Monday that could be affecting you today. And what happens is when you're having an immune-based reaction to something like a banana or egg whites or something like that, that you think are healthy and you're having an immune-based reaction, it can make you sluggish, it can cause joint pain, headaches, brain fog, skin rashes, a lot of things that you might not actually be tying to those foods because you think you're trying to do the right thing and eat the right foods. So what I'm saying is, while I believe that food sensitivities can lead to weight gain, I think it's kind of like a roundabout type of way, meaning like, if you don't feel your best, you're less likely to exercise. If you're inflamed and your joints hurt, again, you're less likely to exercise. You're looking for more like comfort-based foods. You're not doing the things that you need to lose weight. And at the same time, if you've already gained weight and you're not where you want to be, then more inflammation can lead to actually greater amounts of obesity. So it's kind of cyclical. Fat cells or adipose tissue, as it's called, can actually increase estrogen levels, which increase estrogen, which increase cortisol as well. And all of these things can then exacerbate the cycle to make you keep gaining weight. Or as I see it, it makes it harder for a lot of people to lose weight. If you're able to, I actually really like people to do a simple at-home food sensitivity test. If you can't, I'm going to talk about a little bit of an elimination-based diet. But if you're able to, I don't love as much the skin-based ones that you can do for outdoor allergens. Those are perfectly acceptable, perfectly fine. I like the IgG-based testing. And the reason is I'm leaning towards that more right now. And it's because I want to see all of the immune-based reactions people have when they don't even know what food it is that they were sensitive to. Meaning if you ate shellfish or you ate a piece of fruit and your mouth started to get itchy and you got a headache and you got the symptoms of a faster-based immune response, just simply don't eat that food and narrow it down to the meal that you ate right there. But if it goes back a day or 2 days, it's really difficult to ascertain which foods that you are sensitive to. And that's why I recommend this specific type of food sensitivity testing. What we do is a test. You simply poke your finger and you're going to let just little blood droplets come out on a card, and you just mail that card in. You get your results back in about 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks at the latest, and it tells you specifically what foods you are sensitive to. And that's the nice thing, it's customized for you, because this lab only tests healthy foods. And so when you're only looking at healthy foods, you don't have to worry about testing devil dogs or cupcakes or things like that, because we don't need to test for those, because you shouldn't be eating them if you're trying to lose weight. If it's part of every once in a while cheat meal that you'd love to have because it's your favorite food, that's no big deal. But if we're talking about everyday eating and you're having these specific so-called healthy foods that your body's reacting to, that's not going to help with your ability to lose weight. So I hope that answers the question on how food sensitivities very easily and very much can lead to weight gain, or as I would like to say, it actually makes it more difficult for you to lose weight. And that's really the perspective to add it from. So if you're having difficulty losing weight right now, you've tried a lot of things, I would look into food sensitivities. And again, if you can't afford the food sensitivity test, at least start with the main allergens or the main things that people are sensitive to. Some of those top three would be soy, gluten, and dairy. And if you can eliminate at least one or two of those, if not all three, you'll be on your way to at least finding out what some of those main allergens or sensitivities are for the majority of people that can cause inflammation. My suggestion is, if you can, do the food sensitivity test. You just have to do it once in the beginning. Of course, you can retest later down the line to see if you are still sensitive to those foods after an elimination period, but at least take the food sensitivity once. It's great for the whole family to do it, because people are sensitive to different foods. It's not just a genetic-based component, not with an IgG-based food sensitivity. Hopefully that answered your question. Of course, we'll be back with more answers to your weight loss questions very soon. Again, this is the Cabral Concept. Thank you for tuning in with Stephen Cabral.
Are you ready to heal yourself and then go on to heal others? If so, the Integrative Health Practitioner Institute can help you discover proven functional medicine protocols that blend the best of 7 different healing disciplines from around the world. I personally share with you the exact handouts and protocols I use in my private practice that enable people to get well, lose the weight, and live longer, stronger. I want to pass this information on to the next generation of health coaches, and that is exactly why I created IHP. We are the future of the health coaching industry, and the skills and knowledge you will learn will make you an in-demand certified health coach anywhere in the world. Although we have many medical professionals taking the IHP certifications, no experience is necessary, and half our members have no previous health certifications. At the Integrative Health Practitioner Institute, our motto is a health coach in every home. Our goal is that you take this knowledge and then share it with family, friends, loved ones, your community, or any practice where you create a career you love and can be proud of. The global IHP community is filled with some of the most kind and caring people in the world, and we can't wait to welcome you into our world soon. For more information or to set up a discovery call with one of our IHP Health Coach graduates, simply head over to integrativehealthpractitioner.org.